So, for those who were not present on previous lecture, my name is Yuri Panchuk. I'm a senior hardware design engineer in a company called MIPS, which has very long history in embedded microprocessor design. And I'm working on the MIPS i6500 microprocessor cluster, which is used, for example, by Mobileye, which is part of Intel, as a chip for the self-driving car, which will be available in the cars in year 2020. So last time, let's review very briefly concepts we learned last time. So first of all, last time I show how different is hardware design from software engineering. So basically, in any system, you have both hardware and software sides, and we are using hardware description language Verilog and sometimes VHDL to design hardware on register transfer level. So this is methodology which is used since late 80s by like all the companies by Apple, Intel, Qualcomm, and so on and so on. And like basically we use Verilog to design CPU cores and to design interconnect and to design controllers for input-output devices. So, and then you can see the difference that when we write code in software, this code becomes a chain of instructions. So we compile C code into sequence of assembly and they become machine code. But when we design in Verilog, the code becomes chip itself. So transistors on the chip, a physical chip, not just sequence of instructions in memory. But since we cannot manufacture a chip on a silicon foundry, we are using a device called FPGA or field programmable gate array, which is a matrix of reconfigurable cells, which can be used as a substitute for making chip on a factory. And essentially FPGA imitate this fixed chip by connecting special blocks called multiplexers to bit of a memory, which you configure and build circuits inside your chip. Okay, so now let's move from combinational to sequential logic. So last time we learned combinational logic. So conceptually, it is very simple. You just have inputs, you have outputs, and the outputs of group of components depend only on inputs. So you just put some values on inputs and you get outputs after some time. And this group is called a combinational cloud. So you can use combinational logic to calculate logic and arithmetic functions to like do some additions, multiplications, calculate AND, OR, and so on. However, the combinational logic is not enough. First of all, it has interesting problem. Like everything in the hardware does not happen instantaneously. So it takes time for a signal to propagate. It takes time for a transistor to switch. So as a result, when we put some values to inputs, initially on our outputs we get some garbage, we get the noise, so we get some invalid output. So we need to wait for some time when the results are valid, and the question is for how long. So should we wait like one nanosecond, one picosecond, one second. So we can calculate delays in each combinational logic elements. We can also calculate delays for signal propagate in wires. Like we know that with that like light like crosses 30 centimeters in 1 nanosecond, you know. So, but we need some reliable methodology which allow us to guarantee that we have correct results, that enough time that we get methodology which guarantee that the result we are getting now at time t is correct. So in order to do this, we synchronize the computation with a special signal called clock. So what is clock? Clock is a periodic signal with square waveform. So it just goes high and low, and the clock has a positive edge when clock changes from low to high. Clock has a negative edge when clock changes from high to low. Just a second. And basically, we set clock to a period long enough for any combination of computation to compete. And when you go to store and get a computer with like clock speed of like 3 gigahertz or 1 point something gigahertz, we are usually talking about main processor clock. So processors and like other systems usually have multiple clocks, but in our course we will talk only about one clock. So multiple clocks are used for complicated designs where different blocks run on different frequency. But usually a single block runs with a single clock. And the clock on our FPGA board is, on the FPGA board we are using in our lab is generated by a crystal oscillator. So you can find it on the board. So we are not going into details of clock. I saw people like working in Intel, like I saw a person working in Intel who spent his whole life just optimizing niceness of Intel clock. So to make sure that clock goes to various parts of the chip like at exactly the same time, and so on. So this is kind of area of design of its own. But now we just assume that we have absolutely perfect clock, which just goes up and down with square waveform. So now we will talk today about a class of circuits called sequential circuits. So those circuits are synchronized with a clock. And this is the main design methodology which originated in the 1940s and was using in computers since that time. That we have clock and we use clock to synchronize combinational logic. So the sequential circuit goes through a sequence of states. And the current state is stored in a special components called D flip-flops. A new state is computed based on previous state, and then a new state is recorded into D flip-flops when clock goes from low to high. And the outputs of the clock are computed based on inputs in the current state. So you can see waveform diagram that we have a current state, we have inputs, we have new state computed from current state and inputs, and we have outputs. So basically, all combinational circuits you can consider as the construct called Huffman model of combinational circuit. So you have inputs, you have outputs, you have combinational cloud. So we talked about combinational cloud on previous lecture. Then you have state registers that store the current state. And we can compute a new state from previous state. Now, why do we need sequential logic? It actually what makes computers interesting. So without combinational logic, you can only compute some simple arithmetic functions. But with sequential logic, you can memorize information. You can iterate. You can repeat computations. You can wait for something, for some event to come. So on this slide, I show an example of a so-called Chinese room experiment, which is a sort of state machine. So if you don't know about this experiment, read about it in Wikipedia. This experiment is used in arguments whether computer can think. So this is very famous artificial intelligence experiment, and it relates to our subject of sequential circuit. So I put links to several exercises. I don't know how deep you want to go into the area of sequential circuits, but you can follow links and do various exercises. You can experiment with a single flip-flop, which is boring. You can do counter, which just shows counting numbers on seven segment indicator. You can connect flip-flops back to back and make shift register and then have moving LED lights. You can do finite state machines for recognition of sequences. So that you can make some secret code and you can make a circuit recognize the sequence of buttons you press. Then you can use a finite state machine for interfacing with sensors. So this was the question on the previous slide. And you can also understand the concept of pipelining. And after you understand combinational sequential logic pipelining, you can go into learning how microprocessors work. So you can start with a simple designs called school MIPS, learn about processors. We are not going through this on this lecture, but this is something you can do eventually. And design your own processor. So in order to design your own processor, I am essentially giving you all the necessary tools during this lecture and previous lecture. So after these two lectures, you should be able to get some basic tools in hand and design even the simplest processor. So first of all, let's talk about some new syntactic Verilog constructs we are going to use to synthesize sequential logic. So in the previous in previous lecture, we had initial blocks. So initial block is something which is used in simulation, but not in synthesis. But here we have a new construct, which is called always block. Always block is a syntactic construct, means that whatever is inside always block is evaluated every time you have a certain event. And in this particular case, the event is positive edge of clock. So when clock goes from 0 to 1. So, and D flip flop is just a device which acts when clock goes from 0 to 1. And when it goes from 0 to 1, it records its input into its internal state. And after this, it keeps this internal state until the next positive edge clock. So this is effectively just one bit of memory, a primitive memory device, which keeps information for only one clock cycle. So if your clock has frequency of 1 gigahertz, it keeps it for 1 nanosecond. If it's like 10 megahertz, it keeps it for 100 nanosecond. If it's like 1 hertz, it keeps it for 1 second. So now in this always block, we're using a special kind of assignments. Because we have a short lecture, I'm not going to talk how this assignment is treated by a simulator, but this is essentially a non-blocking assignment, which means that you will assign D to Q after you evaluate all always block in your design. So this is how event-driven simulator works. So now, when you have a D flip-flop, you also need to have a reset. So you need to have a special signal called reset. And usually this reset is active low, which means that it is true when it's zero. So this reset allows you to set any your D flip-flop state to zero at any moment. So you need to write always at post edge clock or neck edge reset. And then if, and now we are going into behavioral style construct in Verilog. So if reset is zero, so which means that if not reset is one, then set Q into zero and otherwise put set Q into a new data. So now you can also group several D flip-flops into a group and call it a register. And here is some syntactic sugar how you can make a parameterizable module to store multiple D flip-flops. And like in our company, as well as in like other hardware design companies, we usually have like several libraries of simple primitives. And then we just combine modules like D flip-flops, like multiplexers, like adders to create designs like a processor. So a typical length of processor code in Verilog. So if you are talking about a small core for a microcontroller or something like PIC32 or like microcontroller like AI in Arduino or like ARM Cortex-M in like STM32, it's usually a tens of thousand lines of Verilog code. Like in MIPS MicroActive UP used in microchip PIC32, it's 66,000 lines of Verilog code. Ah, no, sorry, 66,000, it's only in basic configuration of this code. In a microchip device, it's actually more than 100,000. So, and in large processors, it can be hundreds of thousands and millions of lines of Verilog code. Intel has like tons of code, so their processors are very large. So now, if you look to the waveform, you can see that what D flip-flop does when you change value in the middle of clock cycle, just ignores this value on its input. So when D changes in the middle of clock cycle, so between positive edge clock and positive edge clock, it does nothing. And then it waits until clock goes from 0 to 1, and records this value inside. So now if you put two registers back to back, then you can see that the value which came on D appear at Q only two cycles later. What I had to add to those slides is that if you change value in the middle of clock cycle, then nothing happens. You can change it back and forth. So D can become like 1, 3, 5, 4 during one clock cycle, but this only the value when we go from 0 to 1 clock recorded. So now you can compare how adding additional D flip-flop shifts waveform. Yeah, but flip-flop is sort of boring, so let's get to a more interesting element, which is a counter. So you can see how you can add clock to test. So now let's see count. So counter is a thing that counts number. So in this code, we combine register with an add operation which makes adder. So in this module, we have use as an input clock, we have reset, and we have output count. So every time clock goes from 0 to 1, we increment count by 1. And now let's see how it works. So first I will show you how it works up here. So just look at this picture for some time, and then we will go step by step, because this is how counter works. So you see, it counts. In the middle between counting, you have access. X means that this is some random information, some like electric noise. So now let's go step by step. Once you understand this concept, rest of hardware will become much easier for you. Basically, right now we are going through the most difficult thing in understanding hardware, like ever. This is kind of some block, especially when people are trying to teach hardware design to like school children, like in fifth grade or like eighth grade. Usually, like even smallest children, like even children in like first grade, they can learn how to combine and or and have some gates. So this is not a problem. The problem starts when they are trying to build something with flip-flops. But once they understand how it works, like other concepts go much easier. So let's go to slide 1. Yeah. So now in our circuit, we have a register, which is two flip-flops. So two bits of information. We have clock, we have a register, which is on the right, and we have adder. And this adder adds number 1 to 2 bit value. So now register contains 0. And now we are on the output of register, we have 0. So now the 0 gets propagated to adder. So this 0 goes to adder. And right now you can see that adder on its inputs and outputs may contain some random values, some like X's. But what we have inside register is clean. Now 0 enters the adder. So adder output is not stable yet, because adder needs some time to add and to propagate the right value. Now we adder computed 0 plus 1 is equal 1, but register still contains 0, because register ignores input until it gets positive clock going from 0 to 1. So now clock is coming. So, and now clock is coming to flip-flop and the so-called aperture star. So aperture is a short period of time for like when clock changes from 0 to 1, when you can write things inside register. You know that like in photo cameras you have aperture. So when photo camera opens, makes a picture and closes. So this is same idea, that kind of input of D flip-flop or a register opens, stores value and close. So now our one is put into a register. But it is not propagated outside yet. But now we propagate it outside. And for the next clock cycle, until next clock edge comes, this flip-flop will just put one on its output. So now one enters adder, and the adder output is not stable yet. Then we have two, and then clock positive edge clock comes, and our two gets recorded into D flip-flops of the register. And so on. So you can see how it works. So once you understand this concept, everything else gets much easier. So now let's go into finite state machine. Okay, just a second. Okay, how much time do you have? Right. Muhammad? Okay, good. Okay, in this case, I will do this slower. So, let's go through what is a finite state machine. So, first, let's go back to our slides. Let's go back to our slides with Hoffman mother of computer. Of sequential circuits. So basically, you can see combinational clouds, and you can see state registers. So now you see how a special kind of a combinational cloud which implements a state machine. So Mohammed, do students already went through state machine in their mathematics class? So do they understand the concept? Okay. So before I talk about state machine and hardware, I want to talk about this picture of a Chinese room thought experiment. So basically this argument is used in the discussions of artificial intelligence. And did students already learn about a Turing machine? No. So no Turing machine. Okay. So let's talk about this Chinese room thought experiment. So suppose you have a room and a person in this room, and people from outside can put some writings with Chinese characters through the window into this room. And now a person has a book with bunch of rules. And this book says that if you see this character, and if you saw some other characters before, then you can give certain Chinese characters as an out. And if this book is large enough, if this book has a lot of rules, the person may appear from the outside of the room as somebody who knows Chinese language, even if he doesn't. And essentially, people who criticize artificial intelligence efforts, they are saying that you can see that a computer is like this Chinese room, where you have a bunch of rules, you have current state, you have inputs, and you have outputs. But a person inside the room who applies those rules, he has no knowledge of Chinese language. So in this case, who is talking in this room? Because person doesn't understand what he is doing. So critics of artificial intelligence were saying that this thought experiment proves that in artificial intelligence system, you cannot have self-conscious. So self-awareness, sort of feeling that I am a person. So now let's go back to state machines in hardware and look what it is. So I got this example because this is a very convenient example from a textbook, Digital Design and Computer Architecture by David Harris and Sarah Harris. So I personally know David Harris and Sarah Harris, and when I traveled to Russia back in 2011, I noticed that there is some gap in Russian textbooks to learn Verilog and the basics of hardware design, especially processor microarchitecture, and I recommended to management of our company, MIPS, to sponsor translation of this textbook in Russian. So there was some sponsorship, but mostly this was like a volunteer work, and the people in different places in Russia, in Ukraine, and like other countries, they started to use this textbook. I highly recommend this textbook to you. This textbook is very similar to Hennessy and Patterson, but it just combines materials from several textbooks, from like very long book on digital hardware, computer architecture, computer microarchitecture, and so on. So let's look to an example. Suppose we have a magic snail, and this magic snail just scrolls, just moves down a paper tape. And this tape has zeros and ones. And now when snail first see zero and then see one, the snail smiles. So smile is like output of this. So now we need to create a finite state machine to implement snail's behaviors. We need to create a little robot. So first of all, when we do finite state machines, we draw a so-called state transition diagrams. So Mohammed, can you ask students to move hands who can recognize those diagrams? So need to talk about them. Transition diagram. Okay, that's fine. A state machine is a device which has finite state machine. Finite means that it has a finite number of states. So state machine is a mathematical abstraction which has four elements. First it has inputs, then it has outputs, then it has internal state, and it has rules how to go from current state to the future state. And so let's not talk about Mealy state machine because it's like it'd be more tricky. Let's talk about Moore state machine. So Moore state machine on the left. So basically, we start from reset. We start from state zero. So now, if in state zero we observe zero, so arc means that whether we should move to next state. So if in state zero we observe zero, then we go to state one. If we observe one, then we remain in state zero. Now in state one, if we see one, we go to state two. And otherwise we stay in state one. And then if in state one, we see if in state two we see zero, then we go back to state one, and thus if we see one, we go back to S zero. So and when we have when we are in state S two, which means that we recognize the sequence of 0, 1. So basically. How to show it in the best way. It's better to demonstrate on FPGA board, but without FPGA board, let me just show you the code. So let's start from slide about transition. Let's start from this slide. So we have a module. In this module, we have a clock. So clock goes up and down. Then we have a reset. Then we have a signal enabler, which means that whether we need to pay attention to the input A. And we have output Y. And we define three states, state 0, state 1, and state 2. So now we go from state to state. So we implement two D flip-flops to store the current state of snail's brain. And then we have a case statement, which is similar to C switch statement. And we have it in always block, which means that anytime anything, in this case, anytime A changes, then you need to re-evaluate value of next state. And then now we have a rule that if the current state is S0 and we observe 1, then we go to state then we stay in state S0. Otherwise, we go to state S1. So now if we are in state S1, we also observe A, so A is our input. So if we go back to the snail thing, so snail, on every clock cycle, snail see only current 0, 1. And so now after like a large number, like after some number of clock cycles, they will recognize whether it see 1, 0, or whether it see, and each time it see sequence of 1, 0, it will output 1 on signal Y, on output Y, because it's in state S2. So it's really, if you never see state machines before, you should see it on FPGA board. And basically, you can make a design where you put some code, like you connect some keyboard to FPGA board and like enter some secret code. and you can use state machine to recognize the sequence of the code. So this is how you code state machine. Now you can use state machine to interface with sensors. So in order to interface, so here I put links to two examples of very low code for sensors. One sensor is the ultrasonic distance sensor, and another is the digital light sensor with the SPI protocol. And with the SPI protocol, it's essentially a way to transmit zeros and ones sequentially. But with ultrasonic distance sensor, it's something, it uses a different protocol. So if you have, so how much time do you have right now? Like I'm just thinking, should I explain in details how it works? Huh? 25 minutes. Okay, so let's go through pipelining, and then I will explain interface to the sensor. Okay? Because this is something of practical use. You can implement, you can buy this sensor in some like local store connected to a FPGA board and see how it all works together. So yeah, and synthesis tool recognize state machines. So now there is another concept, which is concept of pipelining. So if you have a bunch of computations like F, G, and H, and they require long time, so you can split a complicated computation into several chunks, and instead of running them with a low clock frequency, so you see this like clock period is long, you can just put registers between them, and now when you start processing some one element, you can simultaneously process another element. So you can observe it with arithmetic blocks. So for instance, suppose you have arithmetic block which finds the power of 5. So, and you just push on each clock cycle a number to this pipeline, and while the whole computation for each number takes 4 clock cycles, but because you push into pipeline on each clock cycle, you effectively overlap multiple computations, so you don't wait until the previous one finishes. So, and here is an example of pipelining in a processor pipeline. So this is execution unit of MIPS M5150 CPU core. So it processes a stream of instructions. So when you have instructions like moves Mohammed, did you already go through assembly language and through instructions? Not yet. Yeah. Okay. So basically, once you learn assembly language and once you learn basics of assembly language programming, you will go to the area of microarchitecture, which is how to execute those instructions one after another. And basically, it is done by processing instructions in a pipeline. So pipeline is exactly like a pipeline in a car factory. So to like assemble each car, you need some long time. So the car may go through the pipeline in like days, just one car. But because you split the car assembling operation into simple operations, and you put a bunch of workers who are doing just one operation at a time, cars exits your pipeline every 20 minutes. And this is the same as like processor or like arithmetic pipeline works. That you split some long computation in chunks and then like make a dedicated combinational cloud and a register to do this. Yeah, so like after this course, maybe at the end of, like once Mohammed teaches you how to use assembly language, you can play on FPGA boards with a couple of processor cores. One is very simple. One is like 400 lines of Verilog, which is cool MIPS. And then you can see how real industrial core looks like. Yeah, so this is like end of basic slides. And now let's go to the sensors. And let's go through the code of sensors. So, so any questions on basics of flip-flop register concept of sequential logic? Because this is the most important thing you need to understand how it works. So you have a combinational cloud and you have registers, you compute something on every clock cycle and you store results and then use it to compute something else. So are there any questions? Okay, now let's go through the code of ultrasonic distance sensor. So now I will exit presentation and we'll just go to the code itself. So before we go through this code, let's go to documentation like about this receiver. So this is HCSR01 receiver ultrasonic sensor. So let's go to Spark Electronics and see the documentation. So datasheet example. Yeah, let's go to datasheet. So we have this sensor. Oh, okay, so this is how the thing works. So what this timing diagram tells us? This timing diagram tells us, so this is device which measures distance using ultrasound. So basically, how it works. First, this device supplies, so you need to put for 10 microseconds, you need to output one of signals of this device. So you can this trigger input to module, so you need to put this pulse. So now, if you go back to let's go back to this device again. Yeah, if you go back here, so you can see that it has four pins. So one pin is VCC. VCC is simply five volts. GND is simply 0 volts. So you need to apply 5 volts here and 0 volts here. And then trip is a command you're sending to this device to send pulse. And echo is a response from this device. So now you trigger input to this module and you need to keep the signal for 10 microseconds. And this module has inside a logic that sends you back 8 cycle sonic burst no, sorry, this 8 cycle sonic burst is a sound module sends outside. So it sends sound, and then it gets echo, and then this module gives you a response. So this is, you give trigger input to the module, then module sends sound outside, that module gets echo, and then you module sends you a response. How long did it take for the module to get echo? So this is echo pulse output in a circuit. So now it calculate how far is the signal. So now let's go back to like our code. So we need to create a module that has a receiver. So this module uses clock signal, and we have a 50 megahertz clock on this FPGA board. Then we have a signal reset, which we connect to a button, and we generate signal trig, which is a command to send sound signal, and we get a response. So and now we use those signals to calculate relative distance to the object. So now we use a construct called local param, which is a sort of define of constant. So first we define constant, which is speed of sound. So speed of sound meters per second. So 343 meters per second. Then we get from our data sheet maximum range of this device. Then we get from data sheet measuring cycle in milliseconds. And then we have from data sheet time for the command we need to keep up. And then we use sequential logic to both measure lengths of time to send signals and to get back. So then we have constant for measuring cycle time in clock cycles. So now we measure everything in clock cycles. And we have a constant. So we put a bunch of constants. So we just define a bunch of constants. So now, if we simulate it in a test bench, we print out those constants just to check everything is correct. So now we have in our device multiple always blocks. So let's go through them. First of all, we have a counter for a trigger. In this counter, we check that if we reach a maximum of cycle measurement, then we go back to zero. So this is a counter that counts from zero to a maximum measurement cycle time. So we need this counter in order to measure length of this pulse. So this is our pulse. So then we need to wait for some time after each measurement. So now we need another counter to wait for some time after we send this command. We need to wait until we start receiving this command. So we have another counter. So always on clock, we check whether our counter went to this number. And when it went to this number, we produce a pulse. So when we go to this number, then we output one on signal peak. So basically, we are setting this signal high when it reaches a counter, and then after some time we set this to low. So this this always block gets executed again and again and again. So this is something which gets executed on every positive edge of clock. So then when we have so then we need to figure out whether we are getting echo. So now we are trying to get this signal. So now we are trying to check the moment when this signal was low and it's becoming high. So in order to check this moment, we create a D flip-flop, another register, which stores previous value of echo. So we have previous value, we have current value. And now we have a signal called post-edge echo is when this echo goes from low to high, and next echo when it goes from high to low. So this this wire is one when we are going from low to one, and this wire is negative edge when we go from high to low. Now we have another always block, which is a sort of state machine. It doesn't use case statement, but it's a state machine in any case. So basically here, when we have reset, we set those counters to one. And now if you have post edge, so if this clock goes from low to high, then we put to counter zero. So we have a register counter here, which just count how many clock cycles this thing takes. And this number of clock cycles is proportional to the distance to the object. So we start this counter, and then if you have neg edge echo, so if you catch from high to low, then we record the value of this counter into our output, which is a relative distance. This is our relative distance. But by default, when we don't have postage and we don't have baggage, we just increase counter by one. So essentially when we inside this pulse, we just count number of clock cycles in here. So clock is not shown here, but clock just goes like up and down. So this is how this module works. So this module sends this signal trigger. It accepts signal echo, and it counts the length of this pulse. So now let's see what it does with this length. So if you go back to this whole example, you can see that on top module board wrapper, we have signals which come from the board, which is a clock signal, the signal from key, which is button, signal from switches, signal going to LED, signals to hexadecimal 7 signal indicator. So let me show you this Jurassic board. Second. This is board. Jurassic. Jurassic T. Jurassic main board. Yeah, so you can see this board here, and you can see that this board has a feature. It has seven segment indicator. It has switches. It has buttons. So now we connect the wires from our distance measuring device to this general purpose input-output wires. And then we instantiate a module that sends speaker. So we connect speaker to the signal HCSR04TIG, which is general purpose IO33. So this is a general purpose IO33. So these signals here, those pins are marked as 0. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on until 33. So 33 is here. And we can connect echo to 35. Ah, no, those signals are 33 and 35. So if you go to Jurassic manual, so if you go to Jurassic specification resources, so let's go Jurassic user manual. So when you have such manual, you find GPIO expansion headers, and you can see how you connect pins like wires from your sensor to GPIO 35 and GPIO 33. So you connect those wires here, and also this header has a wire for 5 volts and for 3.3 volt, and this distance measuring device works with 5 volts. So you need to connect one wire here and another wire to the ground, and then you need to connect wires to here and here. So now you put this module, and you synthesize anything together. However, in order to output the number to 7-segment indicator, you need to also instantiate module called display driver. And this module, display driver, looks like this. So display driver is a combinational module, and this module has a 4-bit value, which is a digit, and it gives 8-bit that goes to 7-segment indicator. So in 7-segment indicator, you have segments A, B, C, D, E, F, G. And now we have a combination always block. So this means that every time any input changes, so add star means any input changes, so every time digit is changed, if it's 0, you need to put like 0, which means on segment A, then 0 on segment B. So you can put everywhere except for G and except for dot. So every 7-segment indicator has A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and then it has dot. So here in the top module, we instantiate two digits for display driver, this HC, no, this is actually LED coming from echo and from triggering command. So you need to put relative distance to get from the module to the input of display driver, and then you can get back a set of bits you need to put to 7-segment indicator, to 7-segment indicator outputs. So this is the structure of this whole project. So you can get this whole project connected to FPGA board and just see, and just experiment with figuring out distance. So yeah. So this is like pretty much it. And so this is pretty much it, and you can research everything by looking into Terasic document, by looking into my example code, by looking into documentation for this sensor. So you can put the sensor. But right now, actually, I recommend you to make sure that you understand the work of basic sequential logic, because this is something you're going to need at the end of this course when you go through the structure of processor. So basically, in this course, you will study like assembly programming. So this is the next step, that you study assembly programming, but then you need to go through the structure of processor. And this structure of the processor will be in this course. So you can use the school MIPS as an example of the processor. And once you understand, and in order to understand processor microarchitecture, you need to have very clear understanding of how sequential logic works. In this simple processor, you have only registers, only D flops here and D flip flops here. But for complicated processors, we have multiple layers of flip flops. Yeah, so this is, I think, pretty much it. Okay, so now we have. Okay, just a second. Do you have any questions? Let me. Okay, so we are done, right? Okay, so thank you.